talking about a neighboring country with which we have had the best of relationships in the past is a very tricky business. And I am therefore grateful to you for having advised us about the sensitivity of the situation and be restrained in the language that we use. Madam, I recall, because I spent a couple of years in the Ministry of External Affairs, that dealing with Sri Lanka was one of the easiest jobs while dealing with all our neighbors. Each one of them had some issue or the other, but it was only with Sri Lanka that we could deal on the basis of sovereign equality without any hang-ups either on their side or on our side. And this whole house is aware of the fact that Sri Lanka is one of our closest neighbors, that we have had a civilizational relationship with Sri Lanka, and in modern times, one of the most cordial. But at the same time, the tragedy of the Sri Lankan Tamils is one of the greatest tragedies of our times. And when you are dealing with a neighbor, it becomes very difficult to remain untouched by the events and the goings on which take place in that country. We have been affected. People who have been close to us in Sri Lanka have been badly mauled in this war. And the worst part is that the tragedy of the Sri Lankan Tamils continues. They have not only been massacred, abused, their human rights violated, atrocities committed when the war was on. It is something, as my friend Mr. T.R. Balu has said, which continues even today. Any one of us who saw the picture or watched the video of that young child, 12-year-old, sitting in a bunker, then eating a biscuit, and then his dead body lying on the ground with 5 bullet holes in his chest, cannot remain unmoved by the tragedy of war. If the ugliest face of war was brought home to all of us in this whole long conflict, it is the picture of that innocent child being done to death in a manner which is clearly unacceptable. Madam, my colleague Mr. Balu has described the plight of the Tamils in great detail. I have no wish to revisit that issue in my intervention. But I would certainly like to raise issues of policy in this debate, because I think it is important for this House to tell the government of India what our policy towards Sri Lanka be in the changed circumstances. You are aware of the flip-flops in the past. I am not raising it in a spirit of partisanship, but facts of history are facts of history and cannot be really denied. What happened when the LTTE emerged is well chronicled. We first encouraged them, then we sent our army after them in Sri Lanka to destroy them. They could not be destroyed. 2,900 of our brave jawans and officers lost their life on Sri Lankan soil. There is no memorial to them, madam, in our country. Not yet. It's one of the greatest losses that the Indian Army has ever suffered. And we were back to square one because this policy achieved nothing. Now, we are all aware that in 2005, early 2005, there was a change of government in Sri Lanka. And the present president of Sri Lanka came into office by a very narrow margin. And they engaged the LTTE in a war. The war went on for a while. But they chose the moment of the final assault on the LTTE very carefully. And I want the House to take note of this fact, madam, that the final assault against the LTTE was launched when we were all engaged in the general elections of 2009. We were all busy, all of us here, those who did not succeed and are outside. The whole country was engaged in what? In elections. It was at that point of time that the government of Sri Lanka decided to launch its final assault against the LTTE and against the Tamils of Sri Lanka. And they won a famous victory. Their leader, the LTTE chief, was killed. His son was killed. Thousands of Tamils were butchered, civilians. Untold atrocities were committed. And the war came to an end with the final annihilation of the LTTE in the middle of May when the results of the Lok Sabha elections were coming. You will remember that the counting for the Lok Sabha elections took place on the 16th of May that year. Unfortunately, the triumphalism became a state policy of Sri Lanka after that. And the spirit of triumph continues even today. What was happening, madam, in the government of India at that point of time? When all our attention was on the elections. There is a very famous book written by Nitin Gokhale, who was the defense and strategic affairs correspondent of NDTV, who covered this 33-month Elam war in great detail. And in his book called Sri Lanka from War to Peace, he has openly accused the government of India of being the hidden hand behind the success of the Sri Lankan army against the LTTE. And I'm quoting from that book, although in the initial days, the president was advised, president of Sri Lanka was advised to seek a negotiated settlement with the LTTE. New Delhi saw merit in Sri Lankan president's argument that the LTTE is only biding its time to regroup and rearm itself, and that war was inevitable sooner than later. New Delhi's only concern was that the war should be concluded before the summer of 2009, when India was expected to hold general elections. The Sri Lankan president suggested to New Delhi the idea of an informal exchange mechanism between the two countries and deputed a troika consisting of his two brothers who were holding various positions and his secretary, his own personal secretary. India reciprocated immediately, and our team consisted of the then National Security Advisor, the then Foreign Secretary, and the then Defense Secretary. This was the troika on both sides which was coordinating action. And the action was so well coordinated that the Indian Navy intervened and destroyed the Sea Tigers vessels and broke their back. That was the strength of the LTTE. And once their back was broken, then there was nothing they could do. More importantly, the idea that there was no military solution to the conflict, which had been the centerpiece of our country's policy, was abandoned. From that time until the end of the Elam War, according to this book, we in India never again said publicly or even privately that there was no military solution to the conflict. The then NSA flew to Chennai in April 2009 and met the then Chief Minister and the President of Mr. Balu's party. He flew to Sri Lanka. Nothing happened. They were being told one thing in Chennai and something else in a different language was being conveyed to the Sri Lankans. That was the duplicity of the policy that we were following at that point of time. There's not only evidence. The former commander of the Indian peacekeeping forces, Major General Ashok Mehta, said in June 2009, this is all contemporary evidence, and I quote, "We were complicit in the last phase of the offensive when a great number of civilians were killed. Having taken a decision to go along with the campaign, we went along with it all the way and ignored what was happening on the ground," unquote. Brad Adams, madam, the Asia Director of Human Rights Watch.
The name, I'll have to explain.
Okay, I'm just saying, okay,
please,
cut out the name.
Asia
Director of Human Rights Watch. He is not a government functionary.
That's okay.
He is the head of the Human Rights Watch. Mr. Balu was quoting the Human Rights. Said that India had failed to act when the Red Cross warned it of an unimaginable humanitarian catastrophe. India could have saved many lives if it had taken a proactive position. The Asia-Pacific Director of Amnesty International said, and I quote, "India simply chose to support the Sri Lankan government's notion that it could kill as many civilians as it would take." The most damning evidence, madam, is of course the statement of the then Defense Secretary of Sri Lanka, who also happens to be the brother of the Sri Lankan president. When he said on June 1, 2011, while explaining what was different between 1987 and 2009, my friends will remember that in 1987, there was a campaign in Wadamarachi, which was known as Wadamarachi Offensive, against the Tamil Tigers. And when the war went on for a while, India intervened and stopped the Sri Lankans from completely annihilating the Tamil Tigers. And we know what happened. As a result of India's intervention, the 1987 accord was signed, and the 13th amendment to the Sri Lankan constitution was carried out. The date of that amendment, the year of that amendment, is 1987. What does he say? But comparing 2009 with 1987, he said, the primary problem in 1987 was that the relationship between the two countries, India and Sri Lanka, had not been managed very effectively. But this time, the president of Sri Lanka went out of his way to keep New Delhi brief about all the new developments taking place in Sri Lanka through the Troika. He understood that while other countries could mount pressure on us through diplomatic channels or economic means, only India could influence the military campaign. He went on to add that the relationship between Sri Lanka and India was managed through maintaining a clear communication line at the very highest level in the government. This is the Defense Secretary of Sri Lanka making a statement. Further, after his re-election in January 2010, the Sri Lankan President, Madam, makes a state visit to India. In June 2010, I have here a copy of the joint declaration which was issued then. India repeated the homilies that please seek a peaceful settlement, a negotiated settlement. But there is not a word in that joint statement about human rights violations, about the atrocities committed on the civilian Tamils in the northern province, their massacre, nothing, madam, in the joint statement. In a book which was released in Sri Lanka, which is called, the book is called Gotha's War. The same sentiment is repeated. And that is evidence, sir, of the fact that unfortunately, despite the fact that we knew fully well what was happening in Sri Lanka, we not only kept quiet, we became complicit in the crimes against the Tamils. There is nothing more, no more evidence that you need, because this is confirmed both by Indians as well as Sri Lankans. Sir, I do not know what my other colleagues were doing at that time when this war was going on. But fortunately, I have been able to access some of the statements which I made at that point while stating my party's approach to this problem. I had gone for campaigning in the Lok Sabha elections to Karnataka, man, sir. This was in April, end of April 2009. So what I am saying in this house is not something that I am imagining today. I am quoting evidence from April 2009. The leader of the party to which Mr. Thambidurai belongs had issued a statement saying that India should impose sanctions against Sri Lanka to stop them from carrying out these atrocities. It was in that context that media persons approached me in Bangalore. And this is what I said. And I am repeating because this continues to be the policy of the Bharatiya Janata Party even today. We are not in favor of a separate nation created out of Sri Lanka, but totally against the butchering of Tamil civilians. They have to be protected. The party, that is my party, is for giving rights to the northern Tamils within the integrity and territorial unity of Sri Lanka. Our only concern is and will remain the plight of the civilian Tamil population who are suffering untold misery through military action of both sides, LTTE as well as Sri Lankan government. India must make its intentions very clear to Sri Lanka with diplomatic channels and high power delegations not working. And I just said the NSA was visiting Sri Lanka and coming. The only option left is imposing sanctions on Sri Lanka if it goes ahead and disregards our advice. This is what I had said on behalf of my party, echoing what the leader of the Annadmk had said. This is what we should have done. But again, sir, my friend Vaiko, who used to be a member of this house, he came in August 2011 to invite me to join one of his protest rallies in Delhi against the genocide of the Tamils in Sri Lanka. In his meeting with me, he told me that he had met the Prime Minister and the Prime Minister had told him that India could not impose economic sanctions against Sri Lanka as it would encourage China to displace us as a strategic and trading partner of Sri Lanka. When I asked Vaiko whether I quoted him publicly, he said, I quote. When I went to his rally, I naturally pointed out this statement and said this represented a helplessness on the part of the government of India. And I don't agree that we should formulate our policy, especially neighborhood policy, in a state of helplessness. So today, sir, if I speak on behalf of my party for the Tamils of Sri Lanka, I shed tears on their plight. It is not because this debate is taking place in the House today. It is because we truly feel for our brothers and sisters in Sri Lanka. We truly feel for them. And I'm sorry that there could be people who, either through ignorance or through policy, may not share this view. triumphalism will not work. Even after a war, peace is always negotiated. And therefore, winning the war becomes irrelevant if there is no peaceful resolution of the ethnic problem in Sri Lanka. Sir, what is it that we would like the Government of India to do? And I am making some very, very specific suggestions. We have a friendly relationship with Sri Lanka, but we are a neighbor. Therefore, the right to urge upon them, the right to advise them, the right to remonstrate with them, the right to argue with them, does belong to India. And therefore, I'll suggest the following points for the Government of India as points for action in future. The first is, please urge the Government of Sri Lanka to withdraw its army from the northern province. The war ended 4 years ago. Sri Lanka should already have had normal law and order duties assigned to the police. Let the army of Sri Lanka go back to the barracks. Let them not run the northern province on a daily basis and continue to commit the atrocities to which my friend Mr. Bali referred. That's the first point. Second, let them sincerely implement the recommendations of the LLRC. The LLRC is Lessons Learned and Reconciliation Commission. A very interesting name they have given to this committee, Lessons Learned and Reconciliation Committee. The committee has made recommendations. The Sri Lankan government is not implementing those recommendations. Let them implement those recommendations. Then third, sir, let them implement without any further delay the provisions of the 13th Amendment and more. 13th Amendment plus. And the Sri Lankan government, in its discussions with us, has always promised that they will implement 13th Amendment plus. But I am saying this with some reservations. Why am I saying it with reservations, sir? In January this year, the Sri Lankan government came out with what is called the Divi Neguma Bill. Divi Neguma Bill, which has actually further reduced the powers enjoyed by the provincial councils. Far from implementing the recommendations of the 13th Amendment, far from giving the provinces 13th Amendment plus, they have come out with this Divi Neguma Bill, which reduces the powers of the provincial councils and actually vests more powers in the Minister for Economic Development of Sri Lanka, who happens to be another brother of the Sri Lankan president. When the Chief Justice of Sri Lanka protested, Shirani Bandaranaike, and said this was unconstitutional, she was summarily impeached. And when an international commission was supposed to visit Sri Lanka, they did not allow that commission to visit. Fourth, let an impartial inquiry be held into the charges of genocide and atrocities against the civilian Tamils by the Sri Lankan forces during the Elam War. And it should be an absolutely impartial inquiry with outsiders, people from the outside of Sri Lanka, so that the truth comes out. Next, number five, let there be a clear commitment on the part of the Sri Lankan government that after the inquiry, the guilty shall be punished. Number six, let India not merely vote in the UNHRC, let India, sir, take the lead in drafting the resolution in the UNHRC. Because I read a statement somewhere, and perhaps the Prime Minister said it yesterday, that we look at the language of the resolution and then decide whether we shall vote for it or not. No, let India take the lead in drafting the language of that resolution. Yes, and carry it through the UNHRC. And finally, sir, very importantly, let India convey in no uncertain terms to the other nations in our neighborhood and to the world at large that any undue interference by them in the affairs of Sri Lanka or in India-Sri Lanka relationship will not be acceptable to India. We are always afraid of Big Brother China. China will replace, China will do. No, foreign policy is not conducted out of fear. Foreign policy is conducted out of confidence. And let that confidence inform the foreign policy and the neighborhood policy of the government of India. Sir, India is a country with a great deal of clout. But we seem to have lost that clout. We seem to have lost that momentum. And that is why these kinds of things are happening in our neighborhood. I hope there will be a debate in this house on what is happening in India's neighborhood someday. I don't want to take, you already have rung the bell. I don't want to take your time today on our neighborhood policy. But I'd like to say that when I assumed charge of the External Affairs Ministry from my distinguished colleague, Jaswant Singh Ji, and I went to seek the guidance of my Prime Minister, the respected Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji, I said, what should I do? How should I proceed with my task? And the advice that he gave me was, please take care of our neighbors first. Before India ventures out into the world, our neighborhood must be friendly to India. And therefore, I, as Foreign Minister of India, my first visit was to Male. Sri Lanka was number two. So let India conduct its foreign policy with confidence, with elan. There is a Urdu word called Iqbal.
Iqbal chala gaya hai.
Sarkaren Iqbal par chalti hai.
They have lost confidence completely.
Hamare Iqbal ko kya ho gaya aaj? What has happened to India's Iqbal? That nobody even in our neighborhood is prepared to listen to us. It's a sorry state of affairs, but I hope the government will wake up to it. We have a young, very smart External Affairs Minister. I hope he will do his best to regain the clout that India seems to have lost. Thank you very much.